Good morning. I bring you greetings from Candler and Emery.
Go Candler.
And I bring moral support for some of your pastoral staff. It's been a pleasure to be with you this weekend. We really had a lovely evening last night at Ken and Beth's and with Aaron as well. I've enjoyed getting to know a few of you this morning as well. I must confess I'm here under slightly different circumstances than I intended to be. I wrote Wednesday morning a Father's Day message and then awoke Thursday morning to news from Charleston and decided that a new message needed to be written. So this is not what I intended, but I think it's a good one to hear. The actions of Dylan Roof have, I'm sure, shocked and horrified you as they did so many others. They are only worse for the fact that they took place in a church and desecrated a place supposed to be devoted to peace and to loving God and to loving each other. I'm not a politician. I don't think that a law here and policy there will cure our societal ills. I suspect they go much deeper than that. I am a former pastor. I am now a professor, a theologian, and it is my firm belief that if we are going to move forward in our own lives and as society more broadly, we need to return and to rededicate ourselves to the fundamentals of our faith. And as Christians, those fundamentals are quite simply to love God and to love each other. But love is not an easy thing. And all too often it is precluded or inhibited by many things, but by fear is one that is brought to our mind this time. If anything lies at the origin of this crime on Wednesday night, it seems that fear lied at the origin. Mr. Roof told us that he was afraid that African Americans were going to take over our country. And so fear led to hate, and hate led to murder. But fear is not just a source of racial injustice. Fear can affect everything, and it does certainly affect all of us. It may well, I imagine, affect the victims of this crime. Will they turn to hate in another way? Their fear could lead them to hide from the world, to become recluses, to not venture out anymore. Fear affects us. I know it affects me. I trust it affects you in many different ways. Do things like this lead us to fear in our own hometowns, to fear what will happen to us in our homes, to fear what will happen to our children in our schools? Will fear lead us to not get to know our neighbors as we should, to not reach out to the person across the street that we see needs our help, to not establish a relationship that is in need of love and care and concern, to not be who we should be, who God wants us to be? Fear is It's a potentially devastating thing. You know of a gateway drug. I think fear is a gateway emotion. It can lead us to places that are devastating. Not just for us, but for those around us. So this morning, I would like to talk with you about cultivating faith rather than capitulating to fear. The scripture for this morning's message is one that I'm sure all of you are familiar with, the story of David and Goliath, and I've delayed it to this moment, so hear the word of God as I read it. 1 Samuel 17:32. David said to Saul, "Let no one's heart fail because of him," because of Goliath. "Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are just a boy, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep sheep for his father. Whenever a lion or bear came and took a lamb from the flock, I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its mouth And if it turned against me, I would catch it by the jaw and strike it down and kill it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them. He has defied the armies of the living God. David said, "The Lord who saved me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will save me from the hand of this Philistine." So Saul said to David, "Go, and may the Lord be with you." Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a bronze helmet on his head, clothed him with a coat of mail. David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and he tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk with these. I am not used to them." So David removed them. He took his staff in his hand, chose five small stones from the wadi, and put them in his shepherd's bag in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The Philistine came on and drew near to David with his shield-bearer in front of him. When the Philistines looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" David's staff. And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the bones of the birds of the air and the wild animals of the field." But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the Philistine army this very day to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the earth, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand." When the Philistine drew nearer to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in the bag, took out a stone, slung it, struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. May God bless this reading of his word. The lectionary pairs the story of David and Goliath with the story of Jesus calming a storm for good reason. Both tell of the hand of God amongst his people, and both comment on the faith of those people. The message is clear. See what God can do if only you would believe. But the parallels between these stories don't stop there, for the challenge posed to the belief or faith of the people is also similar. In both cases, the people of God find themselves in circumstances that appear utterly hopeless. And in both cases, those people capitulate to the fear those circumstances evoke, rather than cultivating faith in the face of those circumstances. To fully understand the story of David and Goliath, it's helpful to understand the place it occupies in 1 Samuel's narrative about not David and Goliath, but Saul and David. Let me bring you up to speed a bit. The book begins with Samuel, the last judge of Israel, ruling the people of God. The people, however, are not satisfied with the state of affairs and demand of God a king. A human king they want, not a divine king. They prefer one instead who will be like all the other nations, who will make them like all the other nations. They want to have a king to lead us and to go out before us and to take us to war. God gave them what he wanted, what they wanted. He instructed Samuel to anoint Saul king over Israel. Saul's chief qualifications for this role? He stood a head taller than everybody else. He looked the king. God gave them what they wanted. Saul started out pretty well, but soon he exhibited some concerning traits. He acted and spoke rashly, and he had a tendency to take Israel to war without inquiring of God if he should. Eventually, Samuel tells us, he fails to obey God's explicit instructions, and this grieves God, and God issues a warning. He says, "You will not be the head of a dynastic kingdom. You alone shall rule over Israel from your family." But Saul does not change his ways, and things grow progressively worse, and so does God's consequences. Saul's kingship is now in jeopardy. And Saul and God commands Samuel to anoint David the new king. David is portrayed from the start as a completely different person from Saul. This is very much a study in contrasts. Though described as ruddily handsome, David was no physical specimen, as was Saul. Even Samuel, when he first laid eyes on David, thought that God must be mistaken. This can't possibly be the one I'm here to anoint. But this is all for the good, we're told. For as Samuel learns, unlike people, God is concerned with the heart, not outward appearances. The Spirit of the Lord then departs Saul, comes to rest on David. David begins to serve at times in the court of Saul, here and there going back to shepherd the sheep still, returning at times to play the harp. And it's at this moment in the narrative about Saul and David that we have the story of David and Goliath. The story is pivotal. For David's defeat of the Philistines changes everything. No longer will he be a shepherd moonlighting as a harpist. Saul appoints him general in command of his armies. David's reputation becomes renowned. Everyone in Israel begins to love David. Saul's son swears an loyalty oath with him. Saul's daughter, Michal, marries him. Saul's servants love him. Samuel tells us all of Israel and Judah love David, except Saul. Saul grows jealous and angry, and hatred seeps into his heart, and he looks to kill David. The story occupies the pivotal place in this narrative because here, the contrast between Saul and David is in full relief. Today's reading picks up after the Philistine champion, Goliath, has gone before the Israelite army each day for 40 days to propose single combat with the Israelite champion, a fight to the death and for conquest, winner takes all. This is not unusual in ancient warfare. If you remember your school days, Homer, you may recall the Iliad and the challenge that Menelaus posed to Paris in order to win back his wife, Helen. Or the challenge that Hector poses to Achilles. But unlike those encounters, Israel has no champion that is willing to go forth and face the Philistine champion. But this is a condemning statement when read in light of the rest of Samuel. Israel had asked God for a king who would represent them in war, and war is here. But they have no king who's willing to represent them in war. Saul, the man who looked to be just the warrior king they wanted, refuses to meet the Philistine champion, the representative of Israel's arch enemy, in battle. Why? Saul, the man who was anointed king and whose chief qualification was that he stood a head taller than everyone else, looked across the valley and saw one who stood a head or two taller than himself. Goliath, who we're told stands 9 feet 6 inches, to do modern calculations. Even worse, Goliath had the best armaments the world could provide. A bronze helmet, armor with scales of bronze, greaves covering his legs. There is not a spot on him vulnerable to a sword. He carried a spear with an iron tip that weighed 15, 16 pounds, about what a men's shot put weighs today. And a scimitar, that curved sword, slung across his back. Goliath was a fearsome sight, to be sure. But this was the moment for which Saul had been made king. He was chosen because he looked the warrior. But when he looked across the valley, he saw someone else who looked even more the warrior, and he was afraid. Fear struck deep into his heart, and found no faith to oppose it. Saul did nothing for 40 days. Morning after morning, challenge after morning, Saul hid in his tent. David, on the other hand, cultivated faith. His first words to Saul that we have in verse 32 were, "Let not your heart fail. I, your servant, will fight this Philistine." The message, don't fear. Saul's response, as we now expect, focuses on David's appearance. You can't fight him. You're just a boy. You can almost see Saul pointing across the valley, saying, look at him. Look at you. You don't stand a chance. The verses 34 to 37 show us that David is not about to let appearances lead him to fear. I have struck down the bears and bearded the lions who attacked my sheep, he says. It will be the same for this Philistine, who casts reproach on the armies of the living God. For the Lord saved me from the lion and bear, will save me from this Philistine. The word this here subtly gives you insight into David's thought about Saul. God, he is saving, save me from the bears and lions who attacked me who were attacking my sheep. The bears and lions were doing nothing that offended God. They were just acting like bears and lions. Yet this Philistine, this person, for 40 days, has reproached the armies of God, the living God, and thereby reproached God himself. How much more will God save me when I go and challenge this Philistine? When faced with circumstances that appeared hopeless, circumstances that certainly would engender fear, David did not capitulate to fear, but cultivated faith. The trust that God is at work and will be at work through him. As verses 38 to 40 show, though, Saul was slow on the uptake. His fear still ruled. David, he thought, would stand a far better chance if he was just fitted out like a soldier, if he just appeared to be a champion. The text doesn't bring home to us just how ridiculous a moment this was. David is not a full-grown man, as Saul has already mentioned. He certainly does not compare to Saul, the tallest, the largest, the biggest, the strongest in Israel. And so Saul goes and places his armor on David, and it dwarfs him, and David stumbles about and says, I'm not used to this. I can't fight in this stuff. Saul is blinded by his fear. If only David had the outward trappings of a warrior, he might possibly succeed. David was playing dress up in armor five sizes too large. Unlike Saul, fortunately, David realizes the silliness of this move, takes off the armor, picks up his shepherd's staff, a few stones for his sling, and heads out to fight this Philistine. You know the rest of the story. Goliath lumbers toward David, slowly plodding. David races out, reaches into his bag, pulls out a stone, and throws one at Goliath's forehead. Goliath falls down, face forward on the ground, prostrate before the God he challenged, just as Dagon, the god of the Philistines, fell down every night, face forward, when the ark of the Lord was brought into his temple earlier in the book of 1 Samuel. The story of David and Goliath is not a story about David and Saul at all, or David and Goliath at all. The story about David and Saul, it's a study in contrasts. The contrast between David and Saul. Saul, the man who is made king because of his appearance, focused on appearances. David, the man who is made king because of his heart for God, focused upon God. Saul could not take his eyes off how bad the situation appeared to be. Having no other perspective, he capitulated to fear. David gave not a thought to how the situation appeared to be. His eye was firmly fixed on God, and this perspective allowed him to cultivate faith in a situation that certainly was fearful. Fear. It's a natural thing. It's even a good thing at times. But when we capitulate to fear, when we allow fear to govern our lives and take hold of us in a way it shouldn't, it's no longer good. It's a problem. It's a big problem. Fear can lead us to thoughts and actions that may not only devastate our lives, but the lives of others around us. What do you fear? Each of us.
How long will you be here with us?
The situation. Possibility. The relationship. We all fear our fears lead us to anger, to despair, to apathy. It will, if we let it, solve it. He fears he saw Goliath and he did nothing.
He is God. We will keep praying for you all.
David did not. David kept his eyes fixed on God in the midst of fearful circumstances.
Thank you.
David chose not to capitulate to fear. Cultivate faith. And faith is a powerful thing. Faith can keep us from anger and hatred, from despair and apathy. Faith can generate hope. Faith can encourage. Faith in the living God is a powerful thing. I urge you to think of David, to cultivate faith, to capitulate.
And you have to shake. And you have to catch it in your hand. That's the. Because you can't see when it's going to fall. You have to hold your hand down here. You're trying to make it.
Yeah, it's easy.
Four big ones away.
Sure, I'll stand so pretty.
You can slide over.
So,
okay.
Kind of read it.
Yeah. I don't know if everyone can say that. Okay. De wa ka sili mie moesa ma beki tel buye sili mie moesa ma beki tel buye kidel buye kidel buye kidel buye caché en bayon panier non ma beki tel buye caché en bayon panier non. Ma ben qui t'aime briller, qui t'aime briller, qui t'aime briller, qui t'aime briller. Pas quitter sa tempe tout yel, ma ben qui t'aime briller. Pas quitter sa tempe tout yel, ma ben qui t'aime briller, qui t'aime briller, qui t'aime briller, qui t'aime briller. Briller dans tout le monde blanc, ma ben qui t'aime briller. Brille dans tout le monde là, ma paix qui t'aime briller, qui t'aime briller, qui t'aime briller.